Hello friends, welcome back. So in our previous lecture we witnessed for a UAV to possess longitudinal static stability, it has to satisfy two conditions, which is Cm0 has to be greater than 0 and Cm alpha has to be less than 0, right? So and we also discussed about stability, right? So it is a property of an equilibrium where if the system is able to return to its initial equilibrium once disturbed from it, then we call the system is a stable system, right? And we also discussed about equilibrium and its properties, right? So now let's proceed ahead to figure out how various components of a UAV contribute towards stability of the system. And we also studied that the stability of a system is bifurcated into two parts. The first one is the static stability, the second part is dynamic stability, where the static stability is the initial tendency of the system to come back towards its equilibrium once disturbed from it, right? So in case of dynamic stability, it talks about time history of motion of the system once disturbed from its equilibrium. So if the system is able to return to equilibrium over a period of time by damping out the disturbance that was created, right, which has in fact disturbed from its equilibrium. So if it is able to return to its equilibrium, then we can say the system is both statically as well as dynamically stable. So and we also concluded that dynamic stability will guarantee static stability, but static stability may not guarantee dynamic stability, right? And we are looking at longitudinal static stability of a UAV here, right? And we've considered an example. So we know for longitudinal case, the only moment that can contribute towards stability is the pitching moment, right? So which is half rho v square s c bar times cm, right? So this is what is going to contribute towards restoring moment. So which is very important for a system to be stable. So we need a restoring moment in one form or the other. So in the first case, we considered a pendulum pivoted about a point O, right? And this pendulum of mass m is deflected from its or disturbed from its equilibrium. And once it disturbed from its equilibrium, it tries to oscillate about the equilibrium, about this pivot point. So and finally, if there is damping, it will be able to reach that particular initial equilibrium, right? Isn't it? So that happens only because of there is some restoring moment with respect to about point O by this system, right? So mg sin theta multiplied by L, the length of the pendulum, is what helping your system to restore to its equilibrium, right? So that moment which helps the system to restore towards equilibrium is called restoring moment, and restoring moment is essential for a system to be statically stable here, right? So for a longitudinal case of UAV, we have pitching moment, we have only one moment, which is a pitching moment, and with this pitching moment, we should be able to generate that restoring moment. So, for a UAV to be longitudinally stable, we have witnessed that Cm variation with alpha has to be negative, right? This is dCm upon d alpha. So this is with negative slope, right? So this particular, if the system have this particular variation in the linear range of angle of attack, so if the system have this Cm variation with angle of attack, right, this particular trend that is shown here, so then we can say the system is statically stable. And the other condition that is required is Cm0, that is Cm at alpha is 0. Right, this is Cm0, this particular point corresponds to 0 comma Cm0, and this particular point corresponds to alpha trim comma 0, that is lift Cm moment is 0, so which can be considered as trim state or equilibrium state here, right? equilibrium. Okay. So this Cm naught has to be greater than 0 to trim the aircraft at a positive angle of attack, and Cm alpha has to be less than 0 to have the tendency to produce restoring moment, right? So the necessary condition is Cm naught has to be greater than 0, and the sufficient condition is Cm alpha has to be less than 0, which is dCm upon d alpha have to be less than 0, or in other words, Cm2 minus Cm1 upon alpha 2 minus alpha 1. For each positive change in alpha, there should be a negative change in Cm. That is, there should be a pitch down moment when there is an increase in angle of attack, right? Okay. So now, let us consider this wing. Let us consider this particular wing. It's a rectangular wing, right? So it's just a wing, you know, there is nothing attached to this. It's just a wing, simple wing, straight wing. So if we consider this wing itself as an aircraft, right? So the total lift of this aircraft is nothing but lift of the wing, isn't it? And whatever the moment produced by the wing is nothing but the moment produced by the aircraft itself, right? So by the way, where this moment will act? About the CG here, right? Isn't it? It is about the CG. That is how we defined. We considered a body axis system with its origin at the CG, and about each of those axes which is passing through the origin, we have three different moments, starting with rolling moment about the x axis, pitching moment about y axis, and yawing moment about z axis, right? So if I simply throw this, no, if I simply throw this, what do you expect? What do you expect this wing to do? Just flipping, isn't it? So if I do this again, just flips multiple times, right? So the position from which we started, right, is not able to maintain the same attitude or same state, we can say. So we have released it from a level state in a equilibrium condition, because it is not moving, it is not rotating, and it is static, right? So I am throwing this at a particular equilibrium state, but it is not able to maintain, it is flipping, right? So such a motion is, so we can closely imagine this as an unstable state of this particular CG location, right? So if I have to make this fly, then I have to satisfy these conditions, right? Cm naught has to be greater than 0, Cm alpha has to be less than 0. Now, what is this Cm? It's pitching moment, and this moment is acting about Cg, right? So now first, let us look at where is this Cg. How can I find? So if I can balance this at a given location, I am taking a chord-wise location, right? So let us consider I'm taking this particular chord, and I'm trying to balance this at this chord wise location. So this is almost at this particular location, right? The CG is at this particular location. See, now it is balanced, right? About this particular location, CG is balanced, I should say. Yeah. So this is the location. So almost mid chord, no? Almost. Not mid chord, I should say. Yeah. So close to mid chord. So this is the location at which the current CG location is. So the moment about this CG location is making it unstable, right? We'll see why it is making it unstable in the first place, right? So if I somehow can alter the CG, I should know, I don't know now, I don't have the information whether should I take this CG behind or should I take this CG ahead to make, to satisfy this particular condition Cm alpha. So in order to derive those conditions, let us first look into the contribution of a wing towards stability for a given UAV, right? So let's start with that. So let's assume, from now we'll try to represent the wing while dealing with the stability by the side view. Just this particular airfoil, will draw a particular side view of this wing, and then the characteristics of this, like the lift, drag and aerodynamics, moment about aerodynamic center, will talk about the rest of this, like characteristics of this wing, right? And they are represented at the aerodynamic center, which we have discussed earlier. So before going to this, I would like to postulate these assumptions that we are considering for the rest of this analysis. Or analysis, or say you can say the criteria for this entire stability analysis, these are the following assumptions, where the first one is we assume or there exist a plane of symmetry. So about which the geometry is symmetric, and also the mass distribution. Yeah, and also the mass distribution. Okay, so we have a plane of symmetry. For example, if I take this wing, say at the center, right, at the mid portion of the span, I can say this particular left side wing is symmetric, right? Is symmetric, isn't it? Or the left side wing is a mirror image of right side wing. If I consider a plane here, if I cut this wing at the mid portion of the span with a vertical plane, right? So about that plane, the left side of the wing is mirror image of right side of the wing, not just in geometry but also in mass distribution. That is what it is here, right? The second thing is, longitudinal controls will not generate lateral directional and directional forces or moments. So what do you mean by that? Let us say, so the longitudinal control we know is an elevator. Let us say this is my wing, and say there is a tail in the back, right? So if I deflect the elevator, that is only going to produce the change in the longitudinal forces, which is the lift, overall lift of the aircraft is going to change, and then the moment as well. But it is not going to produce any rolling moment or pitching, yawing moment or any side force, right? The force along y axis. So the long, and vice versa, right? And yeah. So, or the lateral, for example, if there is an aileron deflection, if you deploy ailerons, those are not going to produce any, yeah, longitudinal moments, like it's not going to produce any pitching moment, or it's not going to alter the overall lift of the aircraft just because of the deflection, right? That's the same case with the rudder as well, right? And then the third assumption is, so aerodynamic forces and moments vary linearly with angle of attack. Right. So that's what we assume, a linear variation of aerodynamic forces and moments throughout this analysis. Right. And we consider this description or these derivations what we are going to come up with will be valid only for linear range of angle of attack. Okay. And the final assumption is, so we'll use principle of superposition, right? Yeah. So we'll use principle of superposition, where the forces, the total forces acting on a UAV or an aircraft, will be sum of the forces produced by the independent components. And the same for moments. Let us say if this is my wing and this is my tail, let us assume that, right? So these two together when attached forms a aircraft, and we assume it as a rigid body, right? And then the total forces acting on this aircraft is due, or the moments acting on aircraft is due to the forces and moments created by this wing, and also forces and moments created by this tail. So we'll have a vectorial sum of this, right? Forces and moments from the individual components. So these are the four assumptions that we are going to consider, right, for our derivations here, right? Now let's look at the wing alone contribution. So I'll just erase this part. So I hope you have noted down these assumptions. So from now I would like to deal this it in two halves. Right. So why? Because we have bit lengthy equations during these derivations, right? So let's start with. So for longitudinal static stability, we know Cm naught has to be greater than 0 and Cm alpha has to be less than 0. So we know these two conditions are necessary and sufficient conditions here. And also we have one important thing is, aerodynamic forces and moments, they vary linearly with angle of attack, and we have a plane of symmetry, and also we use the principle of superposition. At the same time, we assume that the longitudinal controls are not going to affect lateral directional dynamics. Okay. So let's look at wing contribution. So what do you mean by this wing contribution? So let us consider the aircraft itself is a wing, right? And we have mounted this wing with respect to fuselage reference line. For the time being, we assume that this wing chord coincides with fuselage reference line. Let us say this is my wing and this is my chord, corresponding chord, which is coinciding with the fuselage reference line. So the FRL here stands for fuselage reference line, right? Let's say this aircraft is moving, which is with wing alone, is moving at a velocity V infinity, which is making and this with respect to this fuselage reference line, it is making an angle of attack alpha, right? So what else we have? So we have this object, right? We have this body, which is wing alone here, right? So we represented this wing. So what else do we represent? Do we need to represent? So in order to characterize this wing, we need to define lift, drag and pitching moment for the longitudinal case about a given reference point, right? If you define that completely, then we'll be able to completely characterize this airfoil or say wing at the same time, right? So let us assume with respect to leading edge, right? With respect to leading edge of this root chord, let us assume the aerodynamic center is located at a distance. Let us say this is my aerodynamic center, AC. AC here stands for aerodynamic center. You can take it down. AC stands for aerodynamic center. So AC subscript W stands for aerodynamic center of the wing here, right? So let us say this aerodynamic center is located at a distance xAC, x A dot C subscript, x A dot C is the location of aerodynamic center with respect to the leading edge of the root chord measured parallel to the fuselage reference line. So what is this? xAC is the location of aerodynamic center, right, with respect to leading edge of CR of root chord, right, leading edge of root chord, okay. This is what we emphasized, like, that's the reason why we solved three examples yesterday, right. So CR, leading edge of the root chord, measured parallel to FRL. So is it visible? Okay, yeah. Okay, now we know what is aerodynamic center, which is XAC measured from the root chord here. So at aerodynamic center, yeah. So say if this is your free stream velocity, then lift will be acting perpendicular to this, right? Which is LW, is a lift of the wing, isn't it? At the same time, you have drag of the wing acting along this free stream. So say this angle is, so this is acting along the free stream direction. And say we have a moment about aerodynamic center, MAC. So pitching moment, assuming that the y-axis is into the bird, so the positive pitching moment will be pitch up notion, right? So this is the moment about aerodynamic center is represented by MAC about this aerodynamic center here. So is that all, or do we have something else as well? So this is an object, right, with some mass. So it has center of gravity, right? So we are talking about a dynamic system, isn't it? When you throw it, so the resultant forces and moments will be acting about this center of gravity. Am I correct or not? So we have to talk about CG as well. Let us say the CG of this object is somewhere here, or say somewhere here. Say this is my center of gravity, okay? So we are now neglecting the Z component, Z offset. So we are now not complicating the system. We assume that the CG is along the fuselage reference line here. So that's a pretty good assumption, isn't it? So that, because the lateral distribution of mass is not much here, right? So we can, and the contribution from the ZCG, or say, okay, you can assume, so there is an offset in the CG, right? Let us do that part as well. So let us say this is my wing, and this is the aerodynamic center on this chord line, and the CG is at an offset with respect to this FRL. Okay, so this is my ZCG, right? So this is my offset. This is my offset here. That is my ZCG, leading edge of the root chord. Let us assume this as XCG, right? Again, measured parallel to, yeah. So this is X CG. So this is the location of center of gravity. So this particular point is the location of center of gravity, and ZCG is the offset there, and XCG is the offset. ZCG is a vertical offset with respect to fuselage reference line, and XCG is the longitudinal offset here, or horizontal offset along parallel to the fuselage reference line with respect to leading edge of this root chord, right? Okay, got it? Now, yes, these are the required variables to go ahead with this wing contribution analysis, right? So for a wing, you have lift and drag produced by the wing about the aerodynamic center, and so yeah, the same can be represented at the aerodynamic center associated with the moment about aerodynamic center, right? Now, so the moments happen about CG, because it's a rigid body, right? If you throw a rigid body, so the moments happen about the center of gravity, right? So with respect to the center of gravity, we will now see when it flies what happened to the moment, right? So moment about CG. So first thing is moment about CG, center of gravity, right? CG of this wing alone configuration. Let's say that moment about CG is MCG, which is equal to moment of the entire aircraft. A by C here talks about entire aircraft here. So is equals to, so A by C stands for aircraft or UAV. Entire aircraft or entire UAV here, right? Now if I want to find the moment about CG, right? So now I have to, so in the body frame here, so now I have to resolve this lift and drag along fuselage reference line and perpendicular to fuselage reference line. Why? Because I have the distance XCG measured parallel to fuselage reference line, as well as ZCG measured perpendicular to the fuselage reference line. Am I correct or not? So this is my perpendicular to fuselage reference line, right? These are the resultant forces which are acting perpendicular to fuselage reference line, okay? So there will be a contribution from lift as well as drag, right? So and then this is the direction in which, right? This is the direction for forces, right, which are acting parallel to the along the fuselage reference line. Am I correct or not? Now, so perpendicular to fuselage reference line, what do you have? So this is separated by an angle alpha, right? So the offset is, angular offset is angle alpha here. Why? Because L is perpendicular to V infinity, right? And this direction of this normal force is perpendicular to the fuselage reference line. So these two are making an angle alpha, and these two will also make angle alpha. You can do it by simple mathematics, right? It's a simple transformation. So because see, this is 90 degrees here, right? So let us say this is my V infinity. So this is 90 degrees, and we know this angle is alpha. So what will be this angle? 90 minus alpha, right? Am I correct? So and we know this fuselage reference line and this pink line, which is perpendicular to fuselage reference line, makes an angle 90 degrees, right? They are perpendicular. So what will be this angle? So we know this angle, and we want to find out this angle, right? So this is 90, and this is 90 minus alpha, that is 90 minus alpha, which is alpha, right? So that is what alpha is here. Similarly, here alternate angles are equal. So here this is alpha, right? So alpha is a angle of separation between drag and the fuselage reference line here, okay? Now, what we have is a drag component and the lift component. So the total forces acting perpendicular to fuselage reference line is L cos alpha plus D sin alpha, right? These are the two forces acting perpendicular to fuselage reference line. And the forces acting along this, let us say this is the positive direction, right? So let us say this is ZCG, and positive direction of X is towards the nose of the aircraft, here towards the leading edge of the root chord. So let us say this is my positive direction, and positive direction of Z forces will be in the downward direction. So I have a component L sine alpha acting in this direction. So along this particular direction, what I have is L sine alpha and minus is the negative direction in which it is acting, right? Minus D cos alpha, okay? If I consider this as the forward direction and I consider this as positive, so then L contributes, lift of the wing contribution is the positive contribution here, L sine alpha minus D cos alpha. D is acting in the along the free stream direction, which is in the opposite direction. A component of it will be D cos alpha, which is in the negative direction that I have according to my convention, right? So this is L sine alpha minus D cos alpha, right? So I have one force, perpendicular force, and an offset between CG and the AC, right? So this is the momentum for this perpendicular force, right? So that will create a pitch up moment here. Am I correct or not? So before that, the moment about of this entire aircraft, what I have is moment about aerodynamic center of wing, right? Am I correct? Plus the perpendicular force, which is L cos alpha minus D plus D sine alpha. It is contributing towards pitch up, right? That's why it is positive contribution, right? Times the momentum between CG and the aerodynamic. See, these forces are perpendicular force is acting at AC here, right? The pink, which is represented by this pink vector, right? Which is L cos alpha plus D sine alpha multiplied by this momentum will contribute towards a positive pitching moment here. And the momentum is XCG. I know XAC. So if I subtract XAC from XCG, I'll have the corresponding momentum. XAC of wing, right? XAC of wing, isn't it? At the same time, I have a horizontal component here, right? So the component which is parallel to fuselage reference line is L sine alpha minus D cos alpha. So multiplied by this vertical offset will give me the corresponding moment here. So again, this force is acting towards the nose. So about CG, this is going to contribute towards pitch up motion, right? Because y axis is into the board and the pitching moment is about y axis, correct? So the curl of my fingers will give you the rotation, positive pitching moment. So the positive pitching moment is nose up and this force, right, is trying to give me a nose up motion here. So this, okay. So this is like plus the force L sine alpha D cos alpha, right, multiplied by what is the corresponding momentum is ZCG, right? It's clear, isn't it? This is because of the horizontal force and the vertical offset of CG with respect to fuselage reference line. This is the moment contribution because of the vertical offset by the horizontal force, right? And it's a positive moment. And we have the vertical, like vertical force and a horizontal offset with respect to CG. So this entire component is going to contribute towards a pitch up motion again, right? And we have moment about aerodynamic center. This is clear, I guess. So now let's further non-dimensionalize this. What I have is half rho infinity V infinity square is the reference velocity of the wing is considered as the reference velocity of the aircraft multiplied by reference wing area is considered as reference area of this aircraft, right? So times C bar is the mean aerodynamic chord of the wing is considered as reference chord length here, reference length for the longitudinal direction, times CM of the entire aircraft, CM AC here. CM A by C is nothing but CM of the entire aircraft here. So half rho V square is the dynamic pressure times the area on which it is acting will get us the dimension of force multiplied by a momentum, which is the reference length here, will get us the moment dimensions, right? Moment or torque dimensions here, and multiplied by the non-dimensional moment coefficient, aerodynamic moment coefficient, which is equals to, so this is for wing, right? So this moment is due to wing, which is half rho V infinity square C bar times CM AC of A dot C of wing, CM about aerodynamic center of wing,
this is this first term. So plus, so we have lift, sorry, I'm sorry, please make a correction here. This is LW and DW. Similarly, this is from the wing, right? So LW, DW, and similarly what we have is the lift contribution towards this normal force to fuselage difference line. Okay. Plus half rho V square S, this lift and drag are generated from the wing. So we know V infinity is at the wing and S is the reference area of the wing, times half rho V square S times, so CL of wing times cos alpha. I am writing cos alpha as C alpha here, right? And similarly CD of wing times sin alpha, I am writing sin alpha as S alpha, times XCG minus XAC of wing. This is this second, no, the complete second term is given by this. Okay. Plus, similarly, what I have is half rho V square S times CL of wing times S alpha minus CD of wing times C alpha multiplied by the Z offset, Z CG. Okay. So this is, this corresponds to this particular second term. So if I non-dimensionalize this, if I divide this equation, entire equation by half rho V square S C bar, what I have is CM of aircraft. I simply write it as CM now. CM itself is the CM of entire aircraft, which is equals to CM AC of wing plus CL of wing times cos alpha plus CD of wing times sin alpha multiplied by X bar CG minus X bar AC of wing, right? Okay. And then plus what I have is CL of wing times cos sin alpha, right, minus CD of wing times cos alpha multiplied by, right, Z bar CG. Okay, so let's see, this contribution is very, very less. No. Further, the ZCZ value will be very less, and assuming a small angle of attack, right? If you assume small angle of attack, sin alpha will be alpha multiplied by ZCG, small alpha, and alpha is already small, ZCG will be further small. So we can neglect this particular contribution, and then including this, if you can notice, CDW, right? So drag is far less than the lift coefficient here, right? At least 1/10 of 1/10 order. So it will be 0.0 kind of, no? So multiplied by this small number will further make it small. So we can neglect this vertical contribution. So we are now neglecting this contribution. So And also, if you assume small angle of attack, so this CD alpha, so cos alpha is 1 and sin alpha is alpha, so CD times alpha will be further a small quantity, so we can also neglect this particular quantity. So how we are neglecting? We assume small alpha and ZCG. So the offset
is very, very small comparatively. This, by neglecting these components, what we have is, what we end up with is Cm is equals to Cm AC of the wing, aerodynamic center of the wing, plus CL of wing times X bar CG minus X bar AC of wing, where all X bar subscript anything is equals to S subscript upon C bar, right? Let it be XCG, XCG bar is equals to XCG upon C bar, XAC bar is XAC upon C bar, right? And ZCG bar is also like ZCG upon C bar. Fine. So we now got what is the pitching moment equation, and we know the pitching moment variation. If we have a linear variation, then we can express the aerodynamic coefficient, moment coefficient here as a linear function of angle of attack by Cm naught plus Cm alpha into alpha. So this is a straight line equation, right? Y is equals to mx plus c, where m is the slope here, x is the alpha in our case, x is alpha in our case, and Cm naught is the offset, y, or you can say y intercept there, right? Do you remember this plot? And also remember our assumption, one of our assumptions where the aerodynamic forces and moments have a linear variation with angle of attack. So what do you mean by linear variation in angle of attack? We can write this as a straight line equation, y is equals to mx plus c. So where, so say this is my Cm and this is my alpha. So this slope is that Cm alpha and this y intercept is Cm naught, right? So y is equals to mx plus c is represented as Cm naught plus Cm alpha into alpha here is equals to, so Cm AC of wing plus, what is the CL of wing? How can we express in the linear regime? It's a total lift coefficient of the wing, variation of lift coefficient with angle of attack, isn't it? So in general, so this is your CL alpha, okay? So in the linear regime, you have CL naught here, right? And you know CL alpha, dCL upon d alpha. So similarly, CL is equals to CL naught plus CL alpha into alpha. Y is equals to mx plus c. So CL of wing will be CL naught of wing plus CL alpha of wing times alpha of wing, multiplied by the corresponding moment arm, which is XCG bar, non-dimensional moment arm, which is XCG bar minus XAC of bar of wing. See, you can see this is non-dimensional, X bar is non-dimensional, X is dimensional. Yesterday we derived in terms of X, right? We solved those three examples in terms of X, which is a dimensional quantity. But here X bar is a non-dimensional quantity. We divided this by a characteristic length. For longitudinal case, it is aerodynamic, mean aerodynamic chord, and for lateral directional case, it will be span of the aircraft. Okay. Span of the wings here, span of aircraft is span of wing. So here we have arrived at an expression where, which is at least having the terms that we are interested in, isn't it? What are we interested in? To figure out what will be Cm naught and Cm alpha of this UAV, isn't it? So yeah, here the UAV is having only wing, right? So we want to know whether this wing is giving Cm naught positive and Cm alpha negative. If that is the case, then we can say wing is contributing towards static stability, longitudinal static stability, right? So now let us look at, so by comparing the coefficients of alpha, so alpha of wing is nothing but alpha. We assume the wing is not in, doesn't face any interference here, and further there is no incidence angle of the wing with respect to fuselage reference line. So in that case, the angle of attack at the wing is equals to angle of attack of the aircraft itself, right? So where alpha is a aircraft angle of attack, which is also equivalent to wing angle of attack here in this particular case, right? So by comparing the constants and coefficients, what I arrive is that Cm naught is equals to Cm AC of wing plus CL naught of wing times X bar CG minus X bar AC of wing, right? So take this to here, otherwise, and by comparing the constants and coefficients of alpha, right, CM alpha is equals to CL alpha of wing times x bar non-dimensional momentum, which is x bar CG minus x bar AC of wing. Okay, so we have arrived at the required two conditions, CM naught condition and CM alpha condition. These are the two conditions. So what we have arrived at is CM naught is, it is CM naught is CM AC of wing, right? So it depends upon moment about aerodynamic center. So it depends upon the type of aerofoil you are using, whether it's a symmetric aerofoil, whether it's a cambered aerofoil or a reflex aerofoil, right? Plus CL naught of wing, right, times x bar CG minus x bar AC of wing. Am I correct? So this is what CM naught is dependent upon. And CM alpha is equals to CL alpha times of wing times CM alpha of the entire aircraft is because of CL alpha of the wing times the corresponding x bar CG minus x bar AC of wing. Right. So okay. Now we want CM alpha has to be negative, right? Isn't it? How can we make CM alpha negative? So these are the conditions for longitudinal static stability which we have to do. CM alpha has to be negative. So we have CM alpha as CL alpha times of wing times the momentum. When this can happen? If, let's look at this first condition. If CM alpha has to be less than 0, then CL alpha of wing times x bar CG minus x bar AC of wing should be less than 0. Am I correct? Since CL alpha of wing is always positive, right? As we increase the angle of attack, the lift will increase irrespective of whether it's a symmetric aerofoil, cambered aerofoil or a reflex aerofoil. Am I correct or not? So CL alpha is always positive, which implies x bar CG minus x bar AC of wing must be less than 0. So this particular quantity has to be negative here, which means the x CG should be less than x AC of the wing here. So that's what the conclusion is. From here, what I can say is x bar CG has to be less than x bar AC of wing. Right. So this is the conclusion to make this CM alpha less than 0. Okay, is it clear? What I mean here, the sufficient condition we try to arrive only when this particular quantity here has to be less than 0, which means the CG distance has to be less than aerodynamic center. Right? So it should lie before the aerodynamic center. What do you mean by XCG less than XAC? So the CG is here, it should be less than XAC, which means it has to lie ahead of this aerodynamic center. Am I correct? So if I place this center of gravity ahead of this aerodynamic center, I don't have much control with aerodynamic center. Once I have a wing, I have an aerodynamic center fixed to it. Right? I can't vary it. If I have to vary it, I have to change the entire planform geometry. So the variable that I have in my hand is the CG. Right? So here, if I have to achieve this particular condition, or if I have to achieve the stability, just like normal pendulum, right? So it oscillates about the equilibrium point. If I have to achieve such a strategy, then I have to make the CG, force the CG to lie ahead of this aerodynamic center, which is the variable in my hand, right? So let's see how that variable, how can I claim that variable is in my hand. Before just proceeding to that, let's also look at the other condition where CM naught has to be positive, right? If CM naught has to be positive, so let's first talk about this. If moment about aerodynamic center, right, of wing, this is 0 for a symmetric. So CMAC of wing, CMAC is equals to 0 for symmetric airfoil. So it is less than 0 for cambered airfoil, positively cambered airfoil. So I am taking that liberty. So cambered airfoil is positively cambered airfoil, right, in my opinion. So and is greater than 0 for reflux airfoils, which we have discussed earlier. Right? Okay. When you talk about symmetric airfoil, right, irrespective of this, first thing is that the CG has to be less than aerodynamic center. Right. So this condition we have arrived irrespective of whether the wing is made out of cambered airfoil or a reflex airfoil or a symmetric airfoil, right? So irrespective of that geometry of the wing cross section, we have to make sure that CG is ahead of the aerodynamic center for a wing alone to be negative, which means the difference is negative, right? So CL naught, if you consider a symmetric airfoil, this is 0 and this is 0, CM naught is 0, right? Am I correct? So and if you consider a symmetric airfoil, a cambered airfoil, this particular quantity is negative, CL naught is positive for a cambered airfoil positively, but XCG minus XAC is negative. If I want to fly this in a stable configuration, then this CG has to lie ahead of the aerodynamic center, right? This particular quantity is negative. So two negative quantities contribute towards CM naught negative. That means the aircraft will immediately dip down to a negative trim angle of attack. Yeah, if I consider a reflex airfoil, this will be positive and this contribution will be negative again. Even for reflex airfoil, CL naught is positive. But you have to make sure, you have to then operate at a very less value of this XCG minus XAC so that the resultant CM naught remains positive for you, for the UAV, right? So is it clear? So for me to make this CM naught positive, I need to first look into whether which kind of cross section I am using, whether it is a cambered, symmetric or reflex. If it is symmetric, there is no point, CM naught will automatically become 0, right? Then I have to continuously create an additional moment from somewhere. So let us consider this, right? So this is made out of symmetric airfoil. If you can see this particular wing and a boom, right? So I have a wing and boom set up here. So this is made out of symmetric airfoil here. Right, so then CM naught will be 0 altogether because the CM about aerodynamic center, which is 1/4 of this chord, which is at this particular location that we have marked here. Right, so this is the aerodynamic center location, and it's a symmetric airfoil. You can see the distribution is even about this particular chord line. This is the chord line you can see, right? And yeah, this becomes 0 now. I may not be able to generate a moment from this particular surface. So what I need to do is I have to place some other surface either ahead or behind to make sure that this particular wing alone configuration along with that particular additional surface produces CM naught positive, right? That's what, right? If I locate a particular surface at certain angle here, if I place that surface, a lifting surface at certain angle and place it, keep it like that, right? Then it will produce an additional moment about CG that may help to achieve this CM naught positive. Okay, got it, right? So that is where we need a tail, right? For a cambered airfoil, we need a tail. Even for a cambered airfoil, let us say, if I take a cambered airfoil here, CMAC is negative and this particular quantity is negative. So I need CM naught to be positive, but how can I achieve? By adding one more surface which can make this, force this system to produce that CM naught positive, right? That we will see how to achieve that particular CM naught. Now coming back to this example, so I have this wing, it's a cambered airfoil, you can see it's a cambered airfoil, right? I just happened to pick it up from my lab, right? So I don't even know the details, but it looks as if it's a more a flat bottom and then maybe a 6 series airfoil, I guess, here. Right, so yeah, or a 5 series airfoil. So initially, do you remember? So when I was trying to throw this object, right, So it is trying to flip, right? Is it not? It's trying to flip. Why? Because here we witness that the CG is almost close to the midpoint of the chord, mid chord of this wing, right? Maybe at least behind the quarter chord. So see, this is the location where I'm able to balance this object, right? So that means the CG is close to this particular location here. If you notice, the CG is close to this particular location. So that means the CG is behind the aerodynamic center. So we know aerodynamic center, yesterday we calculated for different configurations, right? So aerodynamic center, so for a rectangular wing, we don't have any taper here. So it is located at close to quarter chord of this particular cross section, isn't it? So quarter chord may be up, maybe close to this location, right? So but the CG is behind this quarter chord, because of which your wing alone is behaving unstable, right? Isn't it? So let us just try to shift this CG before this aerodynamic center, right? Okay, and try to fly this again and see whether our derivation makes sense or not. No, whatever. So it's highly non-intuitive, isn't it? Why? Because see, we were able to say this condition that Cm alpha has to be less than 0 only after deriving this particular equation. This is where we are able to make a decision that, okay, the CG has to be ahead of aerodynamic center. We can't directly, looking at this aerofoil and I know where is the aerodynamic center, I can't comment about what should be the CG location directly, isn't it? That's what we discussed just before starting this derivation. So now let us try to shift the CG ahead of this aerodynamic center and fly this again and see whether this derivation makes sense or not. Yeah, so now we have added some weights here in the front of this wing, just to make sure that the CG is shifted ahead of this aerodynamic center. Now let's see how to locate this aerodynamic center. Let's quickly, I need some support. Yeah, Prabhajit, can you please help me? Yeah. So I need some support here. I'm using this scale to measure chord length here in the first place. So the chord length is about 22.5. So here it is. 22.5 centimeters is the overall chord. No, I am measuring it from root to tip here, right? So it is 22.5. So 22.5 upon 4 is approximately 5.6, yeah, right? So 5.6 is your location of the aerodynamic center. So if I take 5.6 from the leading edge, right, so be towards the trailing edge, so I will be able to find out the aerodynamic center. So 5.6 here is close to this marking. So we have a marking here. This is the aerodynamic center. Now let me just see whether the CG with this addition of weights has shifted ahead of this aerodynamic center or not. No. At least I expect it to be close to this aerodynamic center. See, so it is almost close to this aerodynamic center. With the addition of these weights, it has shifted close to this aerodynamic center here. So this is the aerodynamic center, and the CG is almost close to the aerodynamic center, right? So I will tell you the reason why I have done that, almost close to reason. So now, so can I throw this? But this time I expect this to fly, because our derivation should hold true. If the derivation to hold true, this should fly, isn't it? So Prabhajit is going to help us. So we will have a similar demonstration what we had it in our previous lecture series. So I'll try to check this out from my hands, right? So Prabhajit, let's hope this will fly, right? Isn't it? Not. I'll try to repeat this, right? So, right, it's able to fly, isn't it? It's not by chance. And let's try this one more time. So I'm again trying to throw this with the same attitude. Yeah, right, it's not at least behaving in a weird way, it's not flipping back, right, it's not behaving unstable. So one more time, so this is funny, right? So perfect, do you accept?
Yes, sir.
Do you accept that this equation holds?
Yes, definitely.
Yeah, fine, good, just come here. So without these weights, So the CG, the CG is almost close to this point. So which is aft the aerodynamic center here. See, we have located with this blue pin. We have located the aerodynamic center with this blue pin. So my finger points the current CG location without any additional loads. This is just a wing alone without any additional loads. So it is aft the aerodynamic center here. So when I try to throw the body, right, in this particular configuration, so this will try to flip. It's behaving unstable. So let me do it again. I'll try to throw it with a higher velocity. So I can't help. Yeah, this equation holds true then.